Penguin Random House Audio presents Take Back the Game, How Money and Mania Are Ruining Kids' Sports, and Why It Matters, by Linda Flanagan. Read for you by Abby Craden. To my mother and first coach, Carol Head, whose strength and warmth taught me how to be. Author's note. To protect the privacy of the girls I coached, I have deliberately changed their names and altered identifying details about them and their families. I've done the same with specific individuals who requested anonymity, as well as the scads of boys and girls who cycled through our family home or populated my son's teams. I've kept their unwitting parents out of it, too. It might be helpful to bear in mind that most anyone referred to by first name alone is a pseudonym. If I included a first and last name, that person has agreed to be publicly identified. I also use the pronouns he, him, and she, her interchangeably. My goal throughout has been to tell the truth about becoming an athlete myself, about rearing a young jock in a sports-obsessed community, and about bringing along another generation of runners in an unfamiliar world. I've also strived to be clear in showing how the youth sports ecosystem has affected families, communities, and individuals, for better and worse. Introduction. The kid was on fire. He crisscrossed between opponents, dribbled left-handed, and snatched balls away from unsuspecting players. One minute he was knifing through a gang of defenders clumped awkwardly around the opposing basket and reaching up for a lefty layup. The next, he was sending laser passes cross-court to a teammate with good hands. Other boys seemed trapped in amber, while this kid danced circles around them. "Go, Paul!" I yelled cheerfully. Paul, I should say, is my son, and I was thrilled to see him lighting up the court. It was a Saturday morning in January, and my husband and I were perched on wooden bleachers in an elementary school gym watching our youngest child dominate another youth basketball game. The gym was stuffy and smelled vaguely of paste and dust, and Paul was drenched in sweat. Always an enthusiastic player, he dazzled that morning, darting around at warp speed and playing all roles on the team, racking up points, stealing lazy passes, grabbing rebounds, rallying his teammates. "That kid must have older siblings at home to play with," a man sitting behind us growled to his wife. When the game ended, Paul loped over to us on the bleachers. Other kids heading toward their own parents called out to him, "Great game, Paul!" One of his teammates gave him a sturdy pat on the back, along with the congratulations. "Hey, nice game," a man said. As we all walked out of the gym together, adults and kids glanced over at us. I draped my arm around Paul's narrow, damp shoulder and lifted my chin. My husband Bob did the same. Swooning with pride, we marched out to the car in the school parking lot and glanced around for others eager to congratulate us. Us. For the next hour or so at home, we huddled around the kitchen table and rehashed the game, recounting Paul's star turns and quizzing him on what he was thinking at the time. While we were at it, I prepared a thick peanut butter and honey sandwich, no crusts, and handed him a tall glass of chocolate milk. Meanwhile, our two older kids, neither of whom would be caught dead watching their little brother play basketball, were splayed out on the soft brown couch in the family room, still in their pajamas, drunk on Full House. Except for the disenchanted siblings, that post-game powwow was an intoxicating, self-congratulatory love fest. Something had come over me as I observed my child shine on the court. It would come over me again later, when Paul excelled on the baseball and soccer fields, too. It was pride, irrational happiness, self-satisfaction, self, joy, a surprising, if unspoken, elevation of standing in the community. Even then, I knew it was weird, a tiny bit shameful, and possibly extremely lame. I recalled how my parents had engaged with my four siblings and me when I was growing up. While they had encouraged our athletic pursuits, carting us to practice and attending games when they could, they hadn't attached their psyches to our performance. Their work, friendships, and other adult responsibilities took precedence. Our games were mindless diversions and an afterthought to their fuller and more complicated lives. but their indifference didn't feel like a deficit of love. Rather, it signaled that my games were my endeavor, and that their affection for me, for all my siblings, was independent of what we achieved in sports. Something had changed. I couldn't figure out why Paul's athleticism seemed to matter so much to me, and why kids' sports animated everyone in my orbit. But I felt that pull from his earliest days. And by the look of the fields around town, all of them cluttered with children dressed in uniforms and ready to play, other parents felt that pull too. These motherly intuitions about sports' inflated role were confirmed after I became a high school cross-country coach. When I stepped outside the gym that first morning, energized and wide-eyed about sharing my sport with the teenage girls gathered around me, I had no clue what was to come. It took about 3 weeks for the combustible nature of youth sports to reveal itself. All around me, parents and coaches began to squabble over practice schedules, playing time, and who did or didn't make the team. The athletic director, God bless him, appeared to spend the first half of his day talking mothers and fathers off the ledge, and the second half advising coaches on how to break bad news to unhappy kids. In short order, my own inbox began to fill with requests from runners, or their parents, pleading for special dispensation. Can I train on grass instead of pavement? May I leave practice early tomorrow for math tutoring? The sports themselves, with all the complicated gifts they can bring, rarely entered the conversation. Running has long been a font of pleasure for me, and not merely for the daily dose of dopamine it sends sloshing through my brain. It's the friendship and camaraderie nurtured over hard runs, sometimes in the foulest conditions, that have made the sport so meaningful to me. When my children were young, I used to meet a posse of fellow women runners every Tuesday at 8:30 to tackle a workout collectively. One especially memorable morning, when we took a left out of the parking lot and headed toward Woodland Avenue, rainwater was already burbling out of potholes on Butler Parkway from the previous night's storm. It still hadn't let up, and the chilly air and drenching rain made the outdoors raw and miserable. It was the kind of day that made even mall walking unappealing, because the trek from the parking lot to the front doors would be enough to soak you. But there we were, a gang of 8 middle-aged women runners of varying experience and ability, heading for the hill we'd vowed to run up again and again as part of our training for upcoming races. We clung to the left side of the road and splashed our way over to the base of the hill, about 2 miles from where we began. Dead leaves had dammed the sewers, forcing the rain into angry rivers that swamped our shoes. Before long, the cheap cotton gloves I'd thrown on at the last minute were saturated, and my fingers started to stiffen. The rain and wind turned up the volume outside, stifling normal conversation. "How many 60-second hills are we supposed to do today?" Anne shouted to me on the way over. A car swerved around us and honked disapproval. When we started the first of our hill repeats, several drivers speeding down the road seemed to gawk at our insouciance. What the hell were we thinking? We headed up the hill in groups of 2, pumping our arms, gasping for oxygen at the steepest part halfway up, and striving to cover more ground in this burst than the one before. "Looking good!" Anne-Marie yelled to runners slaloming up as she worked her way down. Archie and Marianne clapped twice when Anne and I slopped past them. "You got this," I called out in return. Apart from my run years ago during a minor hurricane, or my very short and foolish training run in negative 40-degree weather during college, the conditions on the day of these hill repeats were some of the bleakest I'd experienced. But when the workout was over, after I'd fled to the hot shower and dried my hair and reclaimed my normal body temperature, the warm bliss of human connection crowded out any memories of the bitter driving rain. I'd never felt closer to those women, to Anne, Monica, Archie, Linda, Dawn, Anne-Marie, and Marianne, than I did after that inhospitable run against the elements and our own bodies. Even today, 20 years later, I remember the profound satisfaction that came with triumphing over the unforgiving slope of Woodland Avenue during a low-grade monsoon, all of us bound together by purpose and mutual affection. Sports can do this for you. But the changes that were occurring in youth sports, and by that I mean organized athletics for children of all ages through high school, were undermining their purpose. While no one was looking, when we grown-ups were busy building our own lives and tending our own families, kids' sports took a turn. These shifts became apparent to me while watching my son play and became unavoidable the longer I coached. Most people are oblivious to the dramatic changes that have taken place in youth sports during the last 20 years, Jay Coakley told me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.